All right, so for this week's project, we're going to go back to another viewer-submitted unit. This is a Kenwood car cassette deck, model KRC-858. And this unit comes from Joe, who lives up in Wisconsin. Joe's already sent in one Kenwood car deck for repair. We did a video on that a few months back, very high-end model. This one, not quite as fancy as that one, but still a very nice deck in its own right. And this is a pull-out version. Basically, back in the day, all the manufacturers, or pretty much all of them, started manufacturing these basically where you would mount the sleeve in the car, and then the deck would actually just slide in the sleeve with a male and female type connector. And then when you exited your car, you can just pull the deck out and take it with you to prevent anyone from breaking in your car and stealing it. So, don't remember, it's been a few weeks since I talked to him, so I don't remember exactly what he said was wrong with this, but we'll get it hooked up and we'll find out. We'll come in and take a look at all the buttons on the front and see what features they provided on this one. As for our intro music, we're going to go back to 1985, listening to Aerosmith's Done With Mirrors record. And this was definitely a favorite album of mine to be listening to in my car back in those days. And in my opinion, this would be the last album we would get from this great band to have kind of this dark feel to it. After this, everybody would go to rehab and get cleaned up, and we would start making music like was on the album Pump and more commercially viable type of things. So we'll listen to a little bit of my favorite song from this. This is called The Reason a Dog, and then we'll get started on the Kenwood. All right, we'll come back in and we'll take a look at the buttons and the features provided on this one. Starting at the far left here, the first thing you're going to see is a button with the label Release TPC. Following over to the right here on the right top edge, you'll kind of find out what that means. Theft Prevention Chassis. Right below that, we have something marked High Power with a power fader control, a slider from left to right. In this case, it's marked with an F for front and an R for rear, or at least that's what I would assume that means. We have a bass and treble control along with a position control and a loudness button. And then up and down, soft touch controls for volume and probably to access these things. And then we come over here and we've got a TPC light. I would assume as soon as you push this button and release the handle to pull the chassis or pull the radio out of the sleeve, that light would probably come on. You get an attenuator and the power. Moving over here, we get the display for our tuner and probably all the other features that they give you buttons to switch on and switch off. Right above, right in the center, is the tape mechanism. Kenwood's name and, of course, the Dolby logo and bi-azimuth full logic auto reverse stating all the features of the tape deck. Right up above to the right, there's something marked Pro and then AME. I'm assuming that is a program button, which also doubles as a seek button. Push this and you switch tape directions. Below that, you'll find ILL, which I would assume is illumination. This is going to allow you to switch the illumination of the radio between orange and green, followed by Auto, which I would assume is for the tuner. Got one labeled ANRC. I'm not sure if that is automatic noise reduction. I'm not sure what that is. We'd have to look that up. And below that, we have ABSS, which, again, I'm not sure what that is. We would have to look it up in the book. We have our tuning buttons up and down, which also serve as fast forward and rewind, since this is full logic controlled. And we'll move over to the right, get the light out of our way. They're going to give you the numerics 0 through 9. These also, the first three also serve as metal tape, in case you're using a metal tape, pre-recorded tape you made on a metal cassette. T advance, I don't know if that's tape advance, and then T call, maybe time call or tape call. I'm not sure what those are. Again, we'd have to look those up. And then right below to the left of the zero, you're going to get something labeled PS/eject. And so obviously full logic control, you hit that button and it'll drive the tape out for you. We got a direct button here. This is used to, you hit this button first and then you can just direct entry your station in there instead of having one of the presets. And of course we have the band selectors, AM and FM. All right, picking back up with you. Went ahead and got the lid off the unit. Got speakers wired in to the front outputs of the rear amplifier, and the unit is working. And I did confirm you will need to have these coupled together in order to get front or rear speakers to work. And from what I can gather, this is only preamp out for the rear, not the front and the rear. But yet, this still needs to be coupled together in order to get the front speakers to work. So. And I think it has something to do with this right here, what we were talking about. This is the power fader, as they call it. And I think this is the actual fader for the amplifier. So the power gets louder as to the, if you fade it to the front versus the rear or the center. But yet internal to the radio, there is an actual, what I would consider to be a preamp fader, balance and fade. So again, I'm not sure, but it's looking to me like this one is for the actual amplifier and this one is for the preamp. But yet I'm not sure why they would have that since there's only one set of preamp outs. So anyway, radio's working fine, tuning great, no trouble at all. And this is what I discovered about the tape deck. Seems like it's running a little fast, and not only that, we're just going to go ahead and turn that down. This is playing in the forward direction. Now, if I switch it over, mechanically, it will run in the reverse direction and then switch right back to the forward direction. So yeah, so we definitely got something going on. And I did have an issue when I initially tried it outside the video. I did have an issue with the tape hanging up on eject. I had to actually unplug the radio, plug it back in order to get it to reset itself and kick the tape back out. Now, the fact that this thing will run mechanically in the reverse direction but switches over to the other side leads me to believe there may be something along the lines of a real sensor or something of that nature that might be causing it to kick back. So I'm not sure, but I know the first step, we're gonna have to get the tape mechanism out of it so we can take a look. I wanna look at that belt, see what that looks like. And I think the first steps for that, it looks like if you take a look at this thing, the heatsink and the AFPO and the board for the AFPO are kind of all one assembly, and just a few screws should get the whole thing out of our way, and then that'll give us access to get the tape mechanism out. So I'm going to work on that, and then I'll pick back up with you. All right, as we pick back up here, went ahead and got the cassette mechanism out of the rest of the unit and getting a good look at this belt situation here. And this belt is so old and been sitting on these pulleys in the same position so many years that it's already kind of taken the shape of those. As you see it kind of moving through here, it's got some pretty hard creases in it. And so if we take it off here, you can kind of see, you can see it's got a really hard one right there. And there's another one over here on this side. And when I found the belt, it wasn't actually sitting on the motor pulley correctly, so that's probably what's responsible for the speed issue. But the eject issue would definitely be this, because this belt, the mechanism is responsible for driving the tape out once you hit the button for eject. So this is definitely, there's definitely a belt issue. And as for shutting down when we switch it over to the reverse side, of course, this reel is going to be in forward motion. This one's going to be for the reverse or auto reverse direction of the unit. And just kind of looking this over, there's an assembly right here, a circuit board that has four wires coming out of it, going back over to this side. And I'm going to say there's probably a reel sensor under each one of these. One of those photo sensors that's kind of a pulse sensor. It'll send a pulse up. There's a mirrored, staggered mirror image on the bottom of the reel. And of course, it'll bounce that signal, that pulse signal, back down into the receiver of that pair. And that's how it knows that it's actually still moving. But I don't think both are used in, there's one used for reverse, one used for forward, because if both were used, it wouldn't even work in forward. In the forward direction, it'd shut off too, or it'd just probably just click back and forth. But if you take a look at these wires and you follow these wires over here, they're going into a small circuit board right here. And this board has, it has a switch on it that's got multiple positions, or multiple contacts, I should say. And that switch is responsible for apparently not just switching the heads. So when you go the reverse direction, the other set of heads work. It's also responsible for switching these. And so before we go to the trouble of trying to break all this down and get this out of here, I think what I want to do is I want to take this circuit board off, and we're going to put some cleaner in that switch and see if that problem magically goes away. Now, the fact that I don't have any issue at all with the heads, sometimes when a switch like that will go dirty, and that was a very famous problem in GM's car cassette decks back in the 80s, is eventually that head switching switch would go dirty, and so when you would switch it to the reverse direction, or maybe even the forward direction, you'd lose one channel. I'm not seeing that here, but that doesn't mean that this part of the switch can't be creating a problem. So I think we're going to try to sneak this board out of here, and we're going to put a little cleaner in that and see if that clears up that issue. But first I'll need to find a belt. Let me locate a belt for this thing or see if I got one, and then we'll pick back up taking this board out. All right, as we come back in, I went ahead and got this board off of the unit and thought I was going to get lucky and maybe be able to bend the back of this switch up so I could get some control cleaner down in there, but it's way too tightly made. And so what we're going to have to do is go ahead and remove the switch. We're going to use a little bit of solder wick to do that. And once we get the switch out, then from that point, we can see if we can get the back of it opened up just enough to drizzle in a little control cleaner. And the thing is that we want to be careful here. I'm dealing with a very old switch and one that you ain't getting. And so if anything happens to it, and then at that point we need a donor unit. We should be able to get this out of here relatively easy, I would think. Doesn't look like it's any kind of double-sided traces or anything like that. So this switch should come out fairly easy. To me, this is just the easiest route to go first. We know it's got something to do with this. Mechanically, it's moving. So, you know, this looks like it would be the easiest route to take first. So let's do that. And there's our switch, which is very hot, actually. And so I'm not sure if the thing to do here. Let's see. I'm gonna see if I can pry one of these. And these appear to be very tight. I mean, really tight. And that might be all we need to get something up underneath there to pry the back of it up, maybe. But again, we gotta be like super careful with this thing. Looks like we're getting there, maybe. If I don't wind up breaking the thing off, I got a hole in it, so I think that might be good enough. Maybe. Basically just going to kind of flood the switch, but let's make sure we don't flood anything else at the same time. I'm just going to kind of cover this a little bit while I fill it up full of control cleaner. And it's possible it could just be barking up the wrong tree, but again, this is going to be the path of least resistance to take first before we start tearing into that real sensor assembly. It could be the sensor is bad. There could be a loose connection there too. So let's see if we can get this fixed back. I'm just going to kind of press down on it a little bit here. There we go. Got it put back just about where it was. So that should be good. I'm gonna go ahead and get the board cleaned up, get the switch put back in, and see if we can figure out a way to operate this thing outside of putting it all back together. And we'll try it and see. But definitely was a first step. So give me a moment for that and we'll pick back up. All right, pick it back up with you. Went ahead and got the switch reassembled into the unit and figured out a way to just kind of preliminarily get it working so we could try it out. We don't really need the amplifier to find out if the tape deck is working, but we did need this bottom guard, which has a capacitor on it that is responsible for something in the power supply, so it wouldn't work without connecting that back up. So I kind of got that just stood up in the back here. Got this resting on the front face of the radio so we can see what's going on. And unfortunately, we still have the same problem. The switch was not it. So here we are in forward direction. Switch to the reverse side. It clicks and goes right back to the way it was. So pretty much darkest fears realized. We're gonna have to take this sensor assembly out of it. I've kind of looked at it. It doesn't look like it would be that difficult. It seems to be the only thing that board contains. There isn't any gears that I can see on that board, so we ain't got to worry about any of that. So I think the next step, let's go ahead and get that sensor board out. Let's have a look at it and see. Maybe there's something blocking the sensor. That's possible. Not likely, but possible. And let's also take a look at the solder on that and see if we can get this thing fixed easily. As for the sensor itself, depending on what type it is, might have something we can use there. And in the unlikely event that the sensor or a sensor connection is not it, then we would have to go into the circuitry to find out what might be causing the issue. But I'm still hopeful for something easy here. So let me go ahead and get this apart, get that sensor board out of it, and we'll take a look and see if we can discover something about that. But at this point right now, kind of full on panic mode. I want to make sure that we don't run into a situation where we have a part that's bad that we can't get anymore. You know, I hate to see this deck rendered unrepairable over something as simple as a sensor or some kind of failure of a part that is no longer available. So give me a few minutes for that and I'll pick back up with you. All right, so as we pick back up here, I went ahead and got our real assembly out. That's where that sensor board is located. If we flip this over on this side, with the real sensor board not there, you can tell there's a reflective side. Basically, the way that it works is of the pair, one sends a beam of light up and it pulsates, hits the reflector, and then bounces back down to the receiver part of this. And I'll see if I can get you in here where you can see this a little closer, maybe. And I've looked this over pretty good, and you can check this. Obviously, the light emitter portion of it checks just like a LED would check. The receiver portion, you can check that. You can see how well it responds to light appearing in it versus being covered up. And both of these check just fine. And so I looked at connections here, all that seems okay. And so what I thought I would do, and we'll back up, is you don't really need to have the real assembly in it in order to get it to work electronically. We got basically just a dummy tape here and we'll load this up. And the first thing it'll do is it'll start clicking back and forth. But then if I do this, I'm pretty much duplicating what was going on before I took the real sensor out. And then on the other side. So now it seems like it's working on both. And all that's happening here is this is just a reflective piece of plastic, which actually has an IR detector on it. And it won't switch back and forth. But of course, as soon as I take it away, it'll do that for 3 or 4 seconds and then it'll eject the tape automatically when it doesn't sense any type of real movement on either one. And here comes the tape. So I don't know if by probing into this with probes, and I was using these really fine tip probes, if we had a loose connection there or what, but it is definitely appears to be working now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to touch up the solder on these, and it's really, really thin, and touch up the connection here. And there was also a ground here, but if the ground was bad, it wouldn't have worked in the forward direction. So I don't think that's the issue. I think we had a loose connection at the one that's for that reverse direction reel. So I'm gonna touch these up, we're gonna put it back together, and we're gonna see what's happening. Now we could get it all back together and it still not work. There could be something intermittent, I'm not sure. So I'm gonna start by touching up the solder on both of these, touching up the solder here, and we'll put it back together. And there's absolutely nothing impeding these reels. There's nothing wrong with the reflectors on either one of them. But I'm going to go ahead and clean them up a little bit. And we'll pick back up after I got it back together and see what the result is of that. So give me a moment. All right, so we're coming back after went ahead and soldered up our reel sensor here, thinking that I may have got it in the process of poking around with the probes, and it started working on me. I thought I may have had it fixed, but as it turns out, soldered it back up, put it in the unit, and I had the exact same problem. It switched back over to the forward direction once it's seen no real pulse from the reverse direction. So basically took it all back apart. And what I started working on at that point was trying to decide what is happening with this. Why am I able to take this reflective piece of paper and get this thing to work versus the actual reel spinning on it? There's absolutely nothing wrong with the reflector side of this. The reflector side is perfect. As a matter of fact, I swapped the reels back and forth and it was no change. It still did the exact same thing. But I did notice that as long as this was moving fast, when I had this thing running, if this was moving fast, it would work the way it's supposed to. There wouldn't be any kind of issue with that. And so from that point, I've concluded that there is an issue with this sensor. I do not have one to replace it with. The closest I have, and it's a tiny sensor, is one from this board, which I believe came out of a tape deck, home cassette deck. But unfortunately, the pinout of this is different from the pinout of this one. So I've spoke to the customer, and basically what I'm recommending, since we can't get this piece, is the microprocessor of this unit only really needs to see one pulse. It doesn't look for two, because the switch over here, when it makes its switch to the other side, the other set of heads, it switches the reel to over to the reverse reel anyway. So it only needs to see one reel pulse. So we're going to go ahead and jump the defective reel to the good one. That way, anytime the reel is moving, it only sees the good one operating, and that'll keep the reverse direction moving. I don't see any drawback to doing this. Once I get it back together and have that procedure done, we're going to pick back up and we'll do a quick test with it and see what that looks like. So right now, that's the only plan we got, because we definitely ain't getting another piece. All right, picking back up with you, went ahead and got the mechanism reinstalled in the unit. Go ahead and turn it down for a second. Went ahead and did the modification we talked about, basically just jumping that switch out so no matter what position it's in, the reel sensor for the forward direction is always on. That way the microprocessor sees the reel pulse that it's supposed to see to prevent it from flicking back and forth. As far as the microprocessor is concerned, it doesn't care which pulse it sees because it only sees one at a time anyway. That's what this switch is all about right here. When it switches from one direction, it turns on one reel sensor. When it goes to the back to the other direction, the other sensor is activated. So we've just made it to where the forward sensor is the one that's working all the time. It's working good. Runs in the reverse direction beautifully now, no trouble at all. And we got our speed under control with our new belt. So this thing's sounding pretty good. I want to thank you guys as always. Appreciate you checking out the video this week. And anytime we have a situation like this, I'm always a little disappointed that we weren't able to have the exact thing we needed, but we were able to find a usable workaround that doesn't seem to have any implications thus far. So we'll pick back up on something next week, but appreciate you guys checking out the video and appreciate all the new people too. Till next week, catch you on the next one. Yeah.